with you this morning.
As the Spirit was moving over the water, Spirit, come move over us. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. As the Spirit was moving over the water, Spirit, come move over us. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. Come down, Spirit, when you move, you make my heart pound. When you fill the room, you're here and I know you are moving. I'm here and I know you will fill me. Come down, Spirit, when you move, you make my heart pound. When you fill the room, you're here and I know you
Father, we just want to thank you for your presence here with us this morning. Lord. So amazing, so real. Father, thank you.
It's time for the sleeper to wake. It's time for the old winds to change. I hear the Spirit say it's time. Jesus. It's time for the dead man to rise. It's time for the great light to shine. I hear the Spirit say,
Praise God. How many know, how many believe that God is enough? Do you believe in a God that is Jireh today? Hallelujah. I don't know what you are going through. I don't know what you are believing God for today. But I believe in a God that is Jireh, more than enough. My words come from 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 2. If I could have it up on the screen, please. It says, "For he says, in an acceptable time I have heard you, and in the day of salvation I have helped you. Behold, now is the accepted time, and behold, now is the day of salvation." Turn to somebody next to you and tell, today is your day. Today is your day. I don't know what you're believing God for, but today is your day. If you believed God for something for a time, a period of time, like Abraham who believed for his promise for 25 years, there is a danger of us going passive with our belief. Yeah, we believe God is in the background, but we don't believe it's today maybe. We believe maybe tomorrow, another day in the future. Yes, God promised it, but it's gonna happen. And we just carry on like ordinary days. But God wants you to believe that every day is your day. Every day is your day. Today is your day of salvation. 25 years went past, and one day the Lord turned up at Abraham's tent. And because Abraham believed that every day that he walked was his day, he recognized that it was the Lord. And he said, prepare a lamb, get a naan bread ready. We're gonna have dinner, we're gonna have lunch, we're gonna celebrate, because today is the day that the Lord has turned up at my tent. And the Lord spoke, this time next year, you're gonna have your promise delivered. He's the deliverer. He's the promise keeper. My God is Jehovah Jireh. Come on, hallelujah. Give God a praise if you believe in this place.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father.
Hello. So, I think everybody needs to know why you're here on stage anyway. So, you've been nominated for the Positive Role Model for Race, Faith and Religion category in the National Diversity Awards. So, what are these awards?
Well, I have to say, with awards, I'm a little bit, you know, but it's a compliment because it's an award nominated by your peers. Where they vote for people or nominate people who they perceive as positive role models in particular areas. One of them is race, and I think we can safely say that this week it was nice to have that nomination come through in a week where we had the verdict that we, most of us, hoped for and wanted, and, you know, for the church as well. They've been called out on some of this stuff, so it's been really a compliment to be able to nominate for this.
Amazing. So, how can any of us be a role model to these values? But I think first we need to kind of figure out, what are these values? What does it mean to be diverse? What is the Diversity Awards?
Right. Can you all hear me okay? Excellent. Well, with diversity, it's as simple as it sounds. It's about difference, but it's about valuing that difference. It's being comfortable with people who are different than who you are. How many of us know that we default, don't we, to people who think like us and behave like us? It's just easier, isn't it? It's hard to kind of push through that. So with diversity, it wants you to look at that and think about things like inclusion and belonging and all the different ways that you can value that diversity.
So how can we take that on then? How can we be like you, get an award maybe?
I'm a work in progress, trust me. But I think it's a brilliant question, actually, don't you? That as Christians, we're not in an echo chamber, that we're not just kind of separate to what's going on in the world. And there's loads of values like dignity, empathy, compassion. But for me, I really feel that inclusion is a brilliant value for us as Christians. At work and what I do, I often use the phrase, we shouldn't be doing things to people, but we should be doing them with people. So I think as a Christian, we don't want to just be telling the world Jesus loves you and it's all about pushing out, but we're actually looking at the people that we work with, that we mix with day to day, and actually showing the love of God in that real inclusive way.
So I guess the next question to ask you then is, if you won, what would it mean to you?
The same as it does every day. It would be nice because we all like to be valued, don't we? We all like to be congratulated for what we do. But the bottom line is, it's not really a career choice. It's my lived experience. So what I do is because I'm passionate about it. So it would be great. I'm not going to lie, but it
so
wouldn't change
it.
So
how can we help you achieve that?
Despite being quite a confident person, actually, I don't do very well asking for, like, votes. But you can go on to the National Diversity Awards. There's a search box. If you put in my surname, which is Bluck, B-L-U-C-K, you can go on there and not... You actually have to select it as if you're nominating me, but that's actually a vote. So if you want to do that, that's brilliant. But if you don't, I shall still speak to you.
I would think, as an amazing church as we are, especially as a life city, bringing life into every single person, I have no doubt that this church will be behind you on every step of the way. So congratulations and well done. And I can't wait to see you win that award.
Hey, I want to pick up on Sarah's message. How good was Sarah last week? Come on, let's just give it up for Sarah a moment. How good was she? Before I go any further, I just want to honor a family that have come today. Iffy and S.A. Aduko and their family. Can you just stand a moment? Iffy and S.A. were in our church years and years and years and years ago. Iffy was a worship leader in our church and S.A. was a preaching man. And it's such a pleasure to have you. We're just going to just put your hands towards this family this morning. Father, we're going to pray. And Father, I thank you for them. Father, I thank you that you've kept them. Lord, that you have brought them, Lord, into a place where they are fulfilling your vision, Lord. Your hopes and dreams for their lives. And Father, I pray a blessing over them today. Father, I thank you that you're taking care of them. I thank you for their children. Father, I thank you for their marriage. And Father, I declare many more years of abundant blessing to come for this family in the name of Jesus. Amen. So good to see you guys this morning. Great to have you here. If you are a visitor for the first time and you've wondered what you've walked into, this is church. And it's how it should be. I don't know about you, I've been to those. Well, it's a bit cold in here, so I can't really say that because the heating's still not working. But I've been to those dry and dusty places. But not here at Life City, amen. There is life in the house. And so back to Sarah. Back to Sarah. And what a message, what a prophetic word that was. And she mentioned three words that just went off in my heart, and that was carriers of heaven. She said, we are carriers of heaven. And I was watching a program because I'm a bit of a foodie, for those of you who know me, you know. And I like good food, I like going to places that are good. And I was watching this program about a restaurant in Bristol called The Newt. Some of you may have been there or know of it. And I say that to say this, is that there was a guy there who was talking about why he wanted to take his friend to this restaurant. And he could not stop singing the praise of this restaurant. There was such a passion that was coming out of his life about this restaurant. He was waxing lyrical and saying how amazing it was. And I was there thinking, I have got to go to this place. I've got to go to this place because of what this guy is saying about this place. And then it hit me, because the Holy Spirit always does this kind of thing. And he's saying, that's the kind of passion I want my people to have. So that when they speak, people are saying, I need to go to this place that they go to. I need to go and see and hear it with my own eyes and ears. This place that they talk about called church. I need to go and see and hear about this faith that they talk about in Jesus Christ. Yeah, and yet, unfortunately, I think for so many of us, we will talk more passionately about a restaurant that we have gone to than we would talk about the house of God that we go to week by week. Come on, you can applaud that if you want, because I think that's good. I could stop right there and that would be enough. But I've prepared a whole meal for you here. Is that okay? And the Holy Spirit said this to me. And I always like saying it like that, like we have these conversations, because we kind of do. It's kind of usually at my kitchen table when I'm preparing this stuff, you know. And the Holy Spirit said, Is your witness about your faith, is it a forced thing or is it a thing that flows? Is it like, do you have to sort of force it out of yourself? Do you have to force yourself to try and speak to somebody about what you believe? Or does it flow from you naturally? And I thought, good question, because God always asks the best questions. Have you noticed? And I thought, that's interesting. Does it flow out of me? And then I got a revelation of what we've called this year. We've called this year the year of favor and flow. There is the favor of God upon us, and there is the flow of the Holy Spirit from us. And everything about your life and my life is meant to be a flow. It's not meant to be forced. It's meant to come out of us so naturally, like it did for that person who was talking about a restaurant. It should just flow from us. There should be something that just naturally flows about who we are and who Jesus is and why we believe and why we speak the way we do and why we come Sunday by Sunday and assemble ourselves together, why we sing the songs that we sing and listen to someone speak, hopefully eloquently, from this thing called the Bible. And so what message, here's your question, because I always like to give you a question, don't I? What message are you carrying? What's your message? What's your message? Simon, that's so good. Let's give it up for Simon. Does such a good job. Thank you, Simon. I want to take us to the Gospel of Mark. And I'm going to take you a little bit on a journey today. If I was Phil Gardner, who sat down there, if I was Phil, I would do it in a very eloquent way. And I'd give you the history from the beginning of Genesis through to Revelation, as he does, in his erudite and holistic way that he does. But it's me this morning, so you're just going to have to go with my flow. Is that okay? And I want to read from Mark 1 here. Let me get my glasses out because you know I'm getting older. And it says, the beginning, Mark 1:1, the beginning of the good news about Jesus the Messiah. I mean, right there, it's pretty good, isn't it? The beginning of the good news about Jesus the Messiah. Then it goes on, the Son of God. Well, that's an amazing thing. And then he says, as it is written in Isaiah, the prophet. I don't know about you, but I started thinking, what is the good news? Do you know what the good news is? Do you know what the good news that Mark is writing about here at the beginning of his gospel? We talk about the good news, but what is the good news? That's a good question, isn't it? What is it? If I said to you, tell me what the good news of Jesus Christ is, what would you say? You don't need to tell me right now. You can tell me later when we're outside. And this is what it goes on. And you think, right, it's going to tell me. Yeah, as it's written in Isaiah, it's going to tell me right now what that good news is. And then it says this, I will send my messenger ahead of you who will prepare your way. A voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make straight paths for him. I don't know about you, but that does not tell me what good news is. Does it tell you what good news is? It seems to be speaking about something that's already kind of in process. Is that right? It's like he's saying, yeah, there's a message that's going to come. And it's this thing about prepare the way. Why prepare a way? Prepare a way for whom and for what reason? And that means that right now we've been dropped into something that's bigger than just this verse. We've been dropped into a fact that there's a whole history. Because Isaiah was one of the prophets of God. That means he was one of the mouthpieces that God used to speak his will. And here's Isaiah, and he's prophesying from hundreds and hundreds of years before. And he's talking, yeah, about something that's going to happen in the future. And there's this guy called John, you know, the one who ate locust, had honey, did the sort of whole bearskin kind of scenario. This is what he spoke about. And it's interesting because it's called a prophetic voice about something that will come to pass. And Mark's saying, here's the good news about Jesus Christ, the Son of God, because he gets it right out there, yeah, at the beginning. We're talking about Jesus, who is the Son of God. And I want you to know there's something that's been happening and there's something that's been declared out and there's something that needs to be prepared, yeah, for what God is doing. Are you with me so far? And so we're going to just jump up to Mark 1:14. And it says, after John was put in prison, because they didn't really like what he was saying, Jesus went into Galilee proclaiming the good news This is what he said, verse 15. Notice this. The time has come, he said. The kingdom of God has come near. Look at what it says there. The kingdom, the good news is what? The kingdom of God has come near. This is what the good news is about. The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news. The good news is that the kingdom of God is here. And you might go, well, that's, yeah, we all know that. But we've got to understand that there was something happening that Isaiah was talking about that led, yeah, to Jesus coming, who is the Son of God, to announce this good news, to say, heaven has come near. Well, why has it come near? Does that mean that it's been afar? Are you with me so far? If it's come near, where was it before? Well, good question. So we've got to go back a little bit into the beginning. Are you ready for a bit of a history lesson of the Bible? So it started in the garden. It started in the garden. God created the heavens and the earth. And then he created man and woman. Give it a shout there, ladies. And he put them in a garden. And that garden was a place where there was perfect union between God and man. A place of perfect union between heaven and earth. You with me so far? There was complete and utter connection. And then God speaks. He speaks to man. He says, hey, this is what I want you to do. I want you to be fruitful. Yeah, I want you to multiply. And I want you to have dominion or take authority over everything I've created. What a mandate that is. What a set of instructions. If I could put it another way, he says this, I want you to take authority. I want you to make families, and I want you to occupy what I've created. Wow, what an incredible thing that was said right at the beginning, yeah, when God was in perfect union with man. But then there comes this time of disconnection where man disrupts that perfect union because he disobeys, yeah, what God had told him not to do. And the Bible talks about that as the fall or the sin, yeah, of man or of Adam. And then there's disconnection. So this perfect unity that there was between heaven and earth is now disconnected, and there is not a perfect union any longer because this thing called sin has come in, yeah, and it is a barrier or a blocker between God and man. And sin are those things that we do that simply don't honor God and don't allow God to connect with us. You might have grown up in Sunday school and people would have told you that about this type of sin and that type of sin. But fundamentally, our sin disrupts our union with God. And from that time, things changed. But here's the thing. God still wanted to be accessible. God still wanted connection. He wanted the connection that he had created in the beginning. You know what the Bible says when God created the heavens and the earth? He says, at the end of it, he said, it was good. God looked at his work and he said, that's good. And I'll go one further. When he created man and woman, he looked at man and woman, he said, it is very good. I want you to know from the beginning, God looks at you and I and goes, you are more than good. You are very good. You're something that I want to spend time with. I want to be in connection with. I want to be in relationship with. And because the fact that it all went wrong, and it's an interesting thing, really, isn't it, about how it all went wrong? I want to talk for a moment about a worldview about most people have about Christians and about Christianity. So there's me, here I am, this is the worldview. Here's me, I'm on the planet Earth, and my life's going along, yeah? It's like a line. And depending on how good or how not good I am, I'm kind of racking up points. And then towards the end of my life, I've got two choices. Yeah, I'm either going to heaven or I'm going to hell. You with me so far? And it seems to be dependent, a lot of people think it's dependent on, you know, do I live a good life, do I not live a good life? But somewhere along the line, yeah, I'm gonna go to one place or another. It seems to be a very simplistic view, and I'm not sure that that's what the Bible really teaches us. Stick with me for a moment before you think I'm gonna go off on some weird tangent here. And it's interesting because if God wanted perfect union with his creation, if he wanted that connection, total connection with you and I, and yet we screwed that up a little bit, what was he going to do to bring it back? Well, if you go on a little bit further and you start reading through and you understand about Moses and the nation of Israel, you realize that God introduces a thing called the temple. And firstly, he introduced this thing called the tabernacle in the time of Moses. And it was a place where God's presence resided. And then latterly, there's this guy called King David, yeah, who came into prominence, and he had it on his heart to build a temple, like a physical, yeah, permanent place. And his son Solomon completes that in Jerusalem, and we have Solomon's temple. And when you do any kind of study on the tabernacle or the temple, you realize that right at the center, there's a place called the Holy of Holies, the place where God's presence was, because God wanted connection with man, but he couldn't have that perfect connection because there's this barrier in the way called sin. You with me so far? And so he introduces a thing called animal sacrifice. And so the nation of Israel would sacrifice animals, because there's a principle in the Bible that you need to understand, and it's about blood. I know it's a bit icky and a bit ugh, but the Bible says that there is life in the blood. I don't know about you and I think I'm right here. We have about 7 to 8 pints of blood in our body. And if you don't have blood in your body, then you don't live. Is that right? You got to have blood. There's life in the blood. And so what God did through the temple, he said, you can sacrifice animals to me and shed its blood, and it will cover your sin. You with me? The blood, the life, yeah, that life that you shed, that blood that is shed, will, and here's a word I'm going to introduce called atone. It will atone for your sin. It means it will cover it up. But it only lasted a certain amount of time, and they had to keep doing animal sacrifices. It wasn't a perfect way. It wasn't the best way to deal with how man could come back into connection with God, because what the sacrifice enabled for that sin, you had to be removed so you could come back into a space with God and have connection. You all with me so far? And so it's interesting because we come to this place, and here it is in the Gospel of John. I want to take you there. And this is a really important verse. John chapter 1 and verse 29. And we're going back to that guy called John the Baptist, the one who ate the honey and did the locust and all of that. And this is what he said. He said, the next day he saw, that's John, Jesus coming towards him and said, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Jesus came. And in Mark, he says, I want to declare the good news to you. He didn't say, I've turned up. He didn't say, it's all about me, guys. What he said was, the good news is that heaven has come near again. And John recognizes the purpose of Jesus, and he says, there is the one, the Lamb of God. Notice the language, the Lamb of God, who will take away the sin of the world. It's interesting because in the Old Testament, you can read it there, that once a year, the nation of Israel, the high priest would put all of the sin of the nation on a goat and lead it out into the wilderness for it to die. It was called the scapegoat. And here is Jesus declaring that the good news has come, that heaven has come near. And John declares, there is the one, the Lamb of God, who will take away the sin of the world. Well, how is he going to do that? Because the way that sin was covered was by the shedding of blood. Here is Jesus. What's he doing? He's manifesting heaven on earth. The good news is the kingdom of God has come. Heaven has come back. Yeah, and Jesus is the pathway to reconnection with God. It's not about doing animal sacrifice anymore, because that didn't really work. It was a holding pattern. But God has now sent his son, Jesus Christ, with the mandate, with the purpose to be the Lamb who will take away the sin of the world, so that the kingdom of heaven which has come near can bring you and I back into a perfect union with God again. Are you with me? Jesus is life. It's about healing the sick, forgiving sin, teaching that there's a better way to live. And his death was about creating the pathway to reunite God with man, heaven with earth. And I say all this to get to those three words, carriers of heaven. What does it mean in the light of all of that, that Jesus went to a cross, that his body was broken, his blood was shed, his life was poured out upon a tree for all of humanity, both past and present and future, poured out as the final sacrifice so that you and I could have a clear and unfettered, good word that, isn't it, Phil? Unfettered way back to God again. So I'm going to read something now from the Message Bible to you. I'm going to read it from Matthew chapter 5. So what is our mandate then? With it in mind, if we are carriers of heaven, carriers of the kingdom of God, if what's our mandate? Well, I'm going to read it to you. Are you ready? This is what it says in the Message. Let me tell you why you're here. I love the way that starts. I've highlighted that. Let me tell you why you're here. You may think that you're here to do your own thing. You may think that now that you've become a Christ follower, now that you've come into that place of union again, that you can just live your life the way you want. Oh, no, my friends. Let me tell you why you are here. You are here to be the salt seasoning that brings out the God flavors of this earth. If you lose your saltiness, how will people taste godliness? Wow. You've lost your usefulness and will end up in the garbage. Don't want to be there. Here's another way to put it. You are the light bringing out the God colors in this world. God is not a secret to be kept. I want to tell you, if you're here today and you've called Jesus Christ your Lord and your Savior, he is not a secret that you are meaning yet to keep to yourself. You are meant to be light bringers. I don't know about you, but I would be applauding now. I bet if I was at Elevation, Stephen Furtick Church would be on their feet applauding. Come on, you are light bringers. This is what you're about. God is not a secret to be kept. We're going public with this, people, as public as a city on the hill. If I make you light bearers, you don't think I'm going to hide you under a bucket, do you? I'm putting you on a light stand. Now that I've put you there on a hilltop, on a light stand, what you got to do? Shine. Keep open house. Be generous with your eyes by opening up to others. You'll prompt people to open up with God, this generous Father in heaven. Why are you here? To be light and to be salt. Why are you here? Not to keep the secret of your faith hidden, but to be passionate about it. To sit down with somebody maybe across a meal and not talk about the restaurant, but to talk about the faith that's transformed your life, that's taking you out of darkness and brought you into his ever-present light, to take you from where you were downtrodden and lift you out of your sin because of the sacrifice that Jesus made. You know, when they said to him about the temple and they pointed to Solomon's temple, he said, I'll break that temple down and in 3 days I'll build it again. What temple was he talking about? He was talking about his temple. That he had come, heaven had come. The good news is that heaven is here right now. God has made a way for perfect relationship, perfect connection again. And that's what your life is about. That's what my life is about. And so we get, come on, Phil. And so we get to Matthew 28. And we all know Matthew 28 because it's the Great Commission. But I want to read it to you in a different way today. Is that okay? Verse 18, it says this. Jesus came and told his disciples, notice, I have been given all authority in heaven and on earth. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. In the garden, what was the mandate? Multiply, occupy, take authority. What is Jesus saying now? I've got all authority. I'm giving it to you. It was multiply. What are we multiplying? Go and make disciples. Go and occupy what I've created. What's Jesus saying now? Go to all the nations. Go to all the world. The mandate hasn't changed. It's just the focus because God's got different types of people to work with now. Yeah, it's not something that's disconnected. It's something that's been reconnected. It's a mandate that goes further than just make a family. It's about make a family in all nations. It's about go and proclaim because you have authority. It's about go lay your hands on the sick because they will recover. It's about go share your generosity in your finances because you can lift someone out of where you were and you can bring them up to where you are now in Christ. This is what it's about, people. And so I'm going to leave you. Why don't you stand to your feet this morning? I'm going to leave you with this. We are carriers of heaven. If you want to be a carrier of heaven this morning, come on, just lift your hands in this place. Because this is about a moment right now, and I believe in the power of moments. That Jesus has done everything. It's not about you and I being on planet Earth and just living, hopefully, a good life so that we can get to heaven. No, it's about the fact that heaven is here today. The kingdom of God is here today. You carry the kingdom of God today. Your words, yeah, are words from the kingdom of God today. And Jesus has played his part. He's done his role. And now he's left you and I. And we've got a purpose. We've got a mandate to be the carriers. To take everything of the light and the love and the liberty and the freedom and the peace and the joy, yeah, and everything that God has given because of the great exchange upon the cross, to carry that into our Monday and our Tuesday, to carry it into the lives of people who don't yet know. You don't have to bash them with a Bible. You don't have to be holier than thou. You don't have to have some special moment. All you've got to do across a coffee, say, hey, let me tell you about church on Sunday. We had a great time. Let the passion flow out of your heart about what God has done and who he is. Father, I pray right now, come on, lift your hands in this place. Father, I pray right now for every person here, Lord. Father, I pray for those who know you. Holy Spirit, that you'd speak afresh to their hearts again. That they would know that they are carriers of heaven, carriers of the good news, carriers of your light. That we would be salt, bringing out the God flavors in this world. And maybe you're watching online today, I don't know. Maybe you've listened to something that I've said, and maybe you're there in your lounge as we're here today gathered. And you know you need to get your life straight with God. You need to come into that place of relationship. Maybe you felt disconnected. Maybe you're here today and you felt disconnected from that life and that love. And I believe in this moment right now, you can come into the greatest relationship, the greatest union, where heaven touches your earth, where God shows himself strong to you, where his love penetrates every part of your life. I'm going to pray a prayer and you can pray after me. And if you're there in your lounge or maybe you're out walking the dog, I don't know, you can pray this prayer too. Come on, let's pray this prayer after me. Lord Jesus, I thank you that you love me. I thank you that you came and you gave your life for me. Upon a cross, your blood was shed so that I could come into freedom. And I could come into relationship with you, God, my Father. Jesus, you are my Lord and my Savior. And from this day, I will live my life for you. Amen. Amen. If you prayed that prayer today, we'd love to know. You can make contact through our website. Hey, but if you're here today and you prayed that prayer, why don't you speak to one of our team as you leave today at our Connect table? We'll take time to speak with you. Well, I want you to know you are carriers of heaven. Amen. Come on, let's put our hands together this morning. Come on, God's so good. We're going to finish with Jaira. You want to finish that song?